All right, breaking overnight, Defense Secretary Lloyd Austin ordered a guided missile submarine to the Middle East and asked a carrier strike group to get there as quickly as possible. Israel is bracing for a potential attack by Iran, an attack some anticipate could come within days. CNN National Security Correspondent Natasha Bertrand is at the Pentagon, and you get a sense of this new urgency everywhere, Natasha.
Yeah, John, the U.S. is really trying to send a very strong message here to Iran and its proxies to essentially back off. And the way they are doing that is by really increasing the number of assets that they have in the region right now, including, as you mentioned, by signaling that they are sending this guided missile submarine, this nuclear-powered submarine, to the region, something that is extremely rare for the Pentagon to actually announce. Usually these submarines operate in relative secrecy, and so to announce that this submarine, which is armed with dozens and dozens of cruise missiles, is going to be deployed to the region, really is sending a very loud signal here to Tehran and its proxies that the U.S. is prepared to act on behalf of the Israelis, to defend the Israelis if Iran decides to launch an attack on Israel. And in addition to that, the U.S. has also announced that it is going to be speeding up the deployment of the USS Lincoln carrier to the region, which is set to replace the carrier that is currently in the area, the Roosevelt. It has been operating elsewhere. Now it is going to move quicker to the region following this call that Secretary Austin had with Israeli Defense Minister Yoav Gallant. All of these deployments were made public last night following that call, in which Austin reiterated to the Israeli Defense Minister that the U.S. is prepared to do whatever it takes to defend its ally. Now, of course, this all comes as the region is bracing for this retaliation by Iran following the Israeli, or presumed Israeli assassination of the Hamas's most senior political leader in Tehran earlier this month. It has been really widely expected that Iran was going to retaliate somehow. Really, no one knows exactly when or how that is going to happen. But the Pentagon now placing a number of very strategic assets in the region to try to calm tensions, but also, of course, be prepared to help Israel respond if necessary, John.
A region on edge this morning. Natasha Bertrand, thank you very much.
U.S. Defense Secretary Lloyd Austin has ordered a guided missile submarine to the Middle East as fears grow of a potential attack on Israel. Meanwhile, another barrage of rockets fired from Lebanon into Israel overnight has further heightened tensions in the region. Hezbollah says it was in support of the Palestinian people and in retaliation for Israel's strikes in southern Lebanon. This all comes just days ahead of Gaza's ceasefire talks due to take place on Thursday. A source says that according to mediators, newly appointed Hamas political leader Yahya Sinwar wants a deal. We have team coverage. CNN's international diplomatic editor Nick Robertson is in Tel Aviv, and CNN's senior international correspondent Ben Wiedemann with the latest from Beirut. Nick, let's start with you. Word that we're hearing from the new Hamas leader, Yahya Sinwar, that he wants a ceasefire deal. What do you make of that?
It seems to be a way of putting pressure on Israel and potentially putting pressure on President Biden in the White House to put pressure on Prime Minister Netanyahu to make some compromises in the talks over Gaza, compromises that he hasn't been prepared to partake in before. And the reason for this pressure and the reason for the positioning and the reason that these talks on Thursday are so critical, because it's not just about Gaza. This was put into play, if you will, these talks on Thursday, to try to convince Iran that there was a plausible Gaza ceasefire deal in the works and therefore not to retaliate at an escalatory level against Israel. So, but when you see the U.S. Secretary of Defense moving additional military assets, speeding them into the region, moving the USS Georgia, this nuclear-powered cruise missile-firing submarine, from the Mediterranean into the eastern Mediterranean, those are signals that the U.S. believes that there is the potential that the talks won't go well this week, and therefore that Iran may strike, or they may interpret the fact that the talks are really not going to be any different to anything in the past, and may interpret that as a signal that they may as well go and have their retaliatory strike against Israel. So all of these features right now I think focus on how important those talks are, focus how tenuous they are. Diplomats that I'm talking to in the region who had some hope late last week that a deal could be reached on Thursday are now worrying that that can't happen. And part of it is, and this is Hamas' position as well, that they are not clear what Prime Minister Benjamin Netanyahu is going to do, what he'll tell his officials to do at those talks. That's the concern. So while Hamas says it wants a deal, it's also saying that it's not prepared to go to the talks at the moment. This is in a very, very delicate situation.
Yeah, it sure is. And in terms of the timeline, I mean, we've been talking so much about when, it's not a matter of if, but when Iran will retaliate against the killing of its for a top Hamas leader in recent days. CNN analyst Barak Ravid reported Sunday that two sources say Israeli intelligence has assessed Iran could be planning an attack within days. What are you hearing? And obviously, it does seem, I guess, more imminent with the military posture that we're seeing.
Absolutely, the military posture by the United States tells you that that threat is real and is potentially imminent. Diplomatic sources that I'm talking to say that the hope was that Iran would have a retaliatory strike that was in the limits of the conventions of warfare, not striking at civilians, striking at military bases, and therefore wouldn't cause an escalation. But that cannot be ruled out at the moment. You know, in diplomatic terms, diplomats are looking at this and they can see what's happening in Iran. A new president who's not particularly well bedded in, who is perhaps under pressure from hardliners. They'll see the former foreign minister resigning from his government position as a symbol that the more moderates feel that the hardliners are on the ascendancy in Tehran at the moment. So that sense that Iran could do something that is more escalatory or potentially escalatory is very, very real. It is more on the table now than it felt at the end of last week when there were still hopes about the talks. But the atmosphere around those talks is not positive and is not conducive to a positive or quick outcome. And that was what it was going to take for Iran to be deterred from any escalatory type action.
Some really significant context from you there, Nick, in Tel Aviv. Nick, thank you so much for that. Ben, let's head over to you in Beirut. And as you were saying, Hezbollah reportedly fired some 30 rockets from Lebanon toward Israel. What is the atmosphere like there in Lebanon? And I mean, you've been there for some time. How serious is this as an escalation?
Well, what we saw yesterday was really just more of the same. There has been an incremental escalation or increase by Hezbollah in the amount of attacks it's launching on Israel, though keep in mind that according to one study, for every one attack Hezbollah launches, there are six Israeli counterstrikes. Now, today so far, there have only been two strikes claimed by Hamas. So sort of every day is different, but certainly these strikes are really within the context of what we've seen going back to the 8th of October when Hezbollah first opened fire on Israel. What, of course, everybody is anticipating, expecting, fearing to some extent is Hezbollah responding to the strike Tuesday before last by Israel that killed a senior Hezbollah commander. Hassan Nasrallah, the leader of Hezbollah, has said that that response to that assassination is coming. There's no question about it. The question is, what form will it take? And speaking to my diplomatic sources, they do feel that Hezbollah sort of talked itself into a corner, that, you know, it has to respond, but if it responds too strongly, the Israeli counter response could be very destructive beyond simply the area along the border that has been steadily pounded now going back to October. So in terms of the atmosphere here, what we're seeing is that out of the last 6 days, Israeli warplanes have broken the sound barrier four of those days. We're seeing that more airlines are extending their suspensions of flights to Beirut. The latest one is Swiss Air, which has suspended its flights to Lebanon until the 21st of August. But when you go out into the street, you go to restaurants, there's still people there, perhaps less than before because many have left. But I think, as I've said time and time again on CNN, you know, people here have been on this roller coaster where we've seen escalations, de-escalations time and time again. So in a sense, they're prepared for the worst, but they have no choice but to go about their daily lives as best they can.